I would like to go straight to our dear friend, Leila Mukadem from the African Development Bank. Leila, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Frederic. So do I have the hand to share my screen? That's right. Well,
you should have it. If not, yes. We will share it for you. But if you have it,
okay. Ready, I don't know how to do it.
Okay, we could do that for you.
Oh no, it's not okay, that.
We'll do it from here, Leila.
Yeah, we'll do it from here. No worries.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. And thank you, Frederic, and thank you, Jamel, for inviting me. As Frederic said, I always have been a fan of the jobs for Africa Foundation, and the role that you have to play is critical, and more now than ever in creating synergies among the players. And we await a lot from you. So a lot have been said, and thank you for the rich presentation of the previous speakers. So if you can go to the first slide. A lot has been said, but I will try to be brief and to share with you what was the African Development Bank response. So first of all, Africa growth performance before COVID has been faster than ever. The world's top 10 fast growing economies led this growth. The trends in the wake of COVID-19 estimate that the equivalent of 22 million full jobs will be lost in Africa. And one of the previous speakers, I think it was Jamel, mentioned 16 million right now. Of course, the medium and small enterprises are largely informed, and they provide 80% of Africa employment, and they are at high risk of collapse, and we are conducting several studies on the impact on MSMEs and employment in Africa. And already we can see that the impact is really very negative. 93% of young people in Africa are working in the formal economy, and it can be assumed, and we can see it in the figures, that African youth are and will be among those hardest hit by the long-term economic consequences of the COVID-19. Yet, when we look at responses, the responses beg for the question of how best do we protect existing jobs and nurture an economic recovery that quickly produces new ones, and how can we ensure that these jobs are accessible to the youth population and that the recovery extends to small and medium enterprises, which make 40% of the GDP, even higher if we include the informal sector in emerging markets. And the economic shock of the pandemic is especially harsh for these two groups. For instance, we talk about Africa. In Africa, most of the youth population is low-skilled and likely to struggle in any economic downturn. And many of the SMEs where these young people find employment are in the future, if we don't find the right response, at risk of collapse, and if effective measures to respond to COVID-19 are not implemented. And I think one of the speakers said that already Africa is facing a youth employment crisis. So the effect of the COVID-19 are an unwanted addition to this burgeoning challenge. Next slide, please. Okay, I don't know who is moving the slide. Thank you very much. So these are some of the response that the African Development Bank has structured to support the crisis and post-crisis. And since the scale of the economic crisis began to emerge, the African Development Bank has been leading the calls for government to make the recovery as sustainable and resilient as possible. This means immediately addressing the core issues of global recession, and previous speakers talked about that, and soaring unemployment, and doing so in a way that also takes into account the key challenge of inclusivity. And we know that inclusivity in its large definition, but also in the definition of regional inclusivity and disparity is also has been also hit by this crisis. So as they design what we learned, as they design economic recovery plans, policymakers had and are having, still have heading to make enormously consequential decision in a very short space of time. And these decisions are shaping and will shape economic and social landscape for decades to come, and will also almost certainly determine whether the world has a chance and Africa of meeting its long-term sustainable and green growth prospects. So having said that, the African Development Bank first addressed the limited fiscal capacity. So more resources needed to absorb the shocks, to support the economy, but also to support the social safety net, the cash transfer, and the loss of job. We in 2020 boost the fiscal space of African governments to enable them to effectively respond to this and minimize the effects on jobs and, most importantly, also livelihoods. In the short term, the provision also of adequate liquidity in the financial system. So we have had an important number of projects to support, to allow the banks to provide help to companies, mainly small and medium enterprises with cash flow problems, but also to support the trade, you know, the imports of medical products and equipment as well. So liquidity, it's short-term liquidity that we are providing. Usually we provide long-term liquidity, but also trade finance through trade finance instruments, either as in the form of risk participation guarantee or liquidity as well. We've had, in fact, a master bank's crisis response budget support to support all this, targeting specifically SMEs job creation, especially for women and youth, but also to address the short term of the health and the sanitary crisis for these countries. So I think that's it for the first slide. You can ask question if you need. I don't want to read or to go through in details all the slides. So what we are doing also is starting, we have started since I think March or April to think about the medium term, the post-COVID recovery, and how we can adapting and innovate, work on adapting and innovating for economic recovery for more and better jobs. And someone mentioned the digital economy, which is an important and critical opportunity for Africa. And that would and will provide perspectives for young people. And in fact, when we look at the how we can address that or how we can provide some responses, and we are also discussing with other MDBs, multilateral development banks, to create these synergies together. Africa, in each crisis, and it has been said, there are opportunities, and Africa needs really to accelerate innovative platforms wherever e-learning, e-commerce, e-tourism, e-medicine, e-telemedicine. And we are trying to redirect part of our projects, because besides the fact that we are providing new resources to Africa, as I explained before, we are also restructuring some of our projects to address directly some of the emerging issues. And part of our projects have been redirected to these innovative platforms, in particular e-commerce, e-medicine and telemedicine and e-learning. And We have found that all these developments call for a fundamental rethinking of Africa's skills development, education and labor market policies to position African youth and women to leverage the changing times and to redirect their skills and adapt their business and activities to the current world. So I think this part of rethinking needs maybe with the help of the Jobs for Africa Foundation needs to have all the players around the table to think about that and really have a specific support to this part of skills development, education and labor market policies. As we said, I mean, it's more real than before that 75 million jobs will be displaced by technology by 2022. So it's a reality, and in addition with COVID, these technologies are a real opportunity that Africa must not miss. So if you want Africa to move beyond the crisis, it needs really to go up, so exponential growth. And we cannot do it without rethinking a number of things, in particular this skills development. Next slide, please. So some country options. In Egypt, for instance, the pandemic has accelerated the expansion of digitalization and financial inclusion. And we have some small projects in Egypt, but some budget support that also is addressing this. Small grants that we are providing, electronic portfolios and prepaid cards are issued free of charge for citizens. Banks can open mobile phone accounts for their current clients. Ceilings of payment services through the mobile phone have been adjusted. So these are the kind of things that in all African countries, African countries can do to really have a better or provide a better services to the population at large, including rural population. In Tunisia, an incentive legal framework for startup is reference. So it has been adopted in 2018. In which we have provided a lot of support and is considered as good practice that inspired also other countries such as Senegal. And countries are accelerating the establishment also of technoparks, Senegal, Cabo Verde, Morocco, digital in the form of digital park. Next slide, please. So supporting MSMEs for a better economic resilience and job preservation. I think the previous speaker has talked about industrialization support and repositioning Africa and the world value chain. The free trade agreement cannot happen without that. And Africa is changing its conception way and features with the mid-class population that it's changing the way they consume. And yet we are importing, I think we are importing 130 billion per year for agribusiness products in general. So industrialization will help in two ways. It will help build small and medium industries with a value addition, and it will help also to create regional champions that will themselves create this ecosystem and the ecosystem of small and medium enterprises. So I think this part is, Africa is still not really developed in this part, and if we want Africa to grow, this has to be really worked and supported very very quickly in a very smart way as well, to see what are the comparative advantages of Africa, the links in a sub-region in Africa, how how the value chain could work, etc. So we have a specific strategy on industrialization. It's part of our high five, and our president is very keen on industrializing Africa. Access to finance, I have talked about access to finance, how to also rethink the access to finance. Now MSMEs are in need of working capital. They are also in need of capital, so equity, and how in Africa we can really boost or support and let grow the private equity for SMEs market. Unleashing more capital using guarantee facilities and other risk sharing instruments is important. And I can give you, if there are questions, some key examples of the projects and programs that we've had, and the impact is really very interesting to notice. And also support the formalization of informal sector, which is the debate for decades. I think nobody has found the solution for that. But for instance, in some of the countries that we are supporting through budget support, we have pushed for policy support to identifying alternative ways for identification and formalization of businesses, in particular through the taxation part, but also easing processes. So they are a different animal from very small enterprises that are formal. So informal sector is very different, but also support the informal sector as it is, as informal sector, and support the workers in the informal sector through social safety nets, and through also maybe some vocational training. For instance, one of the ideas that we have, we were discussing based in Morocco, is that let's ask, how can I say it? Let's propose to them to become formal by paying a tax. It can be, something not very high tax. And in compensation, the government allowed them or proposed to them vocational training. So they upgrade in what they are doing. If they are doing agriculture, or they are doing, handicrafts or whatever. So this is what we call the social protection socle. En français, on dit le socle de la protection sociale, that will include also the informal sector. But this may be another debate on that. But it's very interesting to, I think, to think outside the box. We are always saying the same things, but we are not finding any solution on this informal sector. So let's help them move and not consider them as poor or pro-poor, and leave them in where they are and tell them become formal. So I think this part is important also to pursue as a debate. So next slide, please. So no, next slide. This slide.
No, it's not. C'est ça. Is that it? C'est bon?
Oui, c'est bon, celui d'après. Non, c'est celui-là, non? Non, je me suis trompée, c'est celui d'avant, voilà.
Okay.
So, some are also other country options that we have supported. Morocco put in place before the COVID crisis an innovative package through a PPP approach called Intileqa to boost access to finance for MSMEs, combining low interest rates, about 2%, and state guarantee scheme. So this program is now considered as an important part of the economic recovery plan. And this kind of financial support should be completed by technical support for businesses. And we are providing direct support to this initiative, as I said. So this is some of the things that we have to, we can consider it as a pilot in Morocco that we can replicate in other countries. Also, the government of Namibia announced the state guarantee of 500 million concessional rates loan scheme for non-agricultural small business with funds provided through the Development Bank of Namibia. So again, supporting the transition of business toward formal sector, Cabo Verde. They adopted a minimum package of cotization for the micro and small businesses with procedure simplification. They call it the REFMP. And in Morocco recently, in Tunisia, the adoption of self-entrepreneur status is a step into this transition. And finally, Morocco is deploying strategic effort to increase its commercial exchange in Africa. And we have a number of ESW that are ongoing, and one of them financed by the bank on how to support the private sector recovery and investment and export in Africa. Next slide. So we have talked a bit about consolidating social protection system. This is an important issue and important for job protection and also support to vulnerable populations. If we talk about jobs, if we talk about jobs for youth, we have to talk about social protection system, sorry. So from Novici in Togo, Tadamon in Morocco, governments were able to provide emergency support to during the COVID-19 crisis to poor workers in informal sector using the asset of digital evolution. So mobile phone for Novici, cash withdrawal machine in Morocco. And the Novici program has been acknowledged by 2019 Nobel Prize, as you all know. Banerjee, and 600,000 beneficiaries in Togo, 5.5 million of households in Morocco, and 500,000 for formal work. So these are the kind of responses that I think will evolve over time. They cannot be stopped after the COVID, but maybe take another dimension. The Kingdom of Morocco put also on top of his development agenda for 2021, the social protection reform system. And we have been supporting that for, I think now 10 years or so. And taking into account the lessons learned of COVID-19 emergency. And the key challenges that they found, extending social protection to informal sector and liberal professions. Better targeting pools, simplifying processes of distribution, and better optimizing resources. So identifying, in fact, ineffective subsidies. Next slide, please. So skills development and future of the work. I think previous speakers have talked about that, and Professor Mudida in particular, how to revamp the skills development policy and system. Putting emphasis on the future of work is, I think for Africa, it's without being very, very long, it's really the opportunity. And if we don't tackle that, and we know how are our education system, vocational training, if we don't really go into that very quickly, then we will lose the next decade growth that we might acquire from that. So I think it's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much. So maybe at the end I will make some concluding remarks. But I hope this was helpful to give you some, you know, examples of what we are doing and some of my thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Leila. And I liked your last slide, which is also the motto of the Jobs for Africa Foundation, taking Africa to the next level through skills development. There are very interesting questions in the chat. Since you referred to questions, please continue using the chat or the question and answer section for participants.